whether they are voiced and voiced or voiceless. So these are the three team labeling for consonant sounds. So when we move on to the next block, you will see the classification of vowels. In addition to that, we will also see the suprasegmental features. So that is what is dealt in the next block. Shall I move on to the next block?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So let me take my PPT. Hold on. Is it clear to you? Is it visible?
Yes,
Yes,
ma'am.
ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
So
ma'am.
in this block, we are going to see the classification of vowels, mainly the classification of vowels. In addition, you'll also see suprasegmental features, whereby we see pitch, intonation, and so on. Starting. Okay, before that, I think I've mentioned you what is received pronunciation, that is RP. It is the standard accent. The standard accent, which is followed in England, that is called the received pronunciation, or the British accent, the standard British accent, which is followed all over the world, that is called the received pronunciation or RP. It is also known by other names like Queen's English, King's English, Oxford English, BBC English. But we'll better go for the term received pronunciation, that is RP. So this is the English which is used in public schools in England, like Eton, Rugby, and so on. And this is the same English which is used in the prestigious universities like universities of Oxford and Cambridge. So this is the received pronunciation or standard accent. Okay. So it is again, it is not an accent. It is an accent, not a dialect. It is not a dialectical variation. Rather, it is an accent. Okay. So they all received all the standard, all the speakers of English, all the educated speakers of Britain use this RP, received pronunciation. Is the idea clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So in America, they follow the standard English, which is used by CNN or the main American universities. In India, we also have a standard Indian accent. The English, which is used in Akashvani, the English, which is used in the national television, national channels. Okay, so that is the standard Indian accent. Anyway, we will follow RP, that's the standard accent used in England. Moving on. So let us recall the definition of vowels that we have seen in the other block. Could you just tell me what is the definition of vowels?
Sound produced without the obstruction of air.
Obstruction in the oral passage. Don't forget that this obstruction doesn't happen in the oral passage. While we see that they are all voiced sounds, so that there is kind of obstruction that is happening in the vocal cords, because the glottis is closed, so that air gets in with some pressure so that the vocal cords vibrate, and thus we get voiced sounds. All the vowels are voiced sounds. So you should specially mention that obstruction, there is no obstruction in the oral passage. The airstream, when it passes through the oral cavity, doesn't get obstructed. That is that is how we get the classification of vowels, how we get the definition of vowels. There are 20 vowels, as we discussed earlier, which can again be subdivided as monophthongs and diphthongs. There are 12 monophthongs and 8 diphthongs that we are going to see now. And there is something called the cardinal vowels. Actually, cardinal vowels are vowels which are used for reference only. Okay, again, that is based on the part of the tongue, then the height to which the tongue is raised. But we don't use the cardinal vowels, but they are used just like a point of reference. You will see that a cardinal vowels, you can see the cardinal vowels from this diagram. So Daniel Jones, I have told you about Daniel Jones. His English pronouncing dictionary is very important if you want to improve your English pronunciation. So according to him, there are 8 primary and 10 secondary cardinal vowels. So this is a diagram that shows these cardinal vowels. They are just used as point of reference. Moving on. So the vowel phonemes. I've told you about monophthongs and diphthongs. Monophthongs are single sounds. So let us see the monophthongs. So again, we can classify the monophthongs. We can divide the monophthongs as short vowels and long vowels. If you see a colon which follows a vowel, that is a long vowel. You can see that certain vowels are followed by a colon. So they are long vowels. And there is a slight difference for one vowel from the other rest of the vowels. That is, the vowel E uses capital letter I. Did you see that? All the rest of the vowels use small letters. Can you see that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now let us read the vowels. So first one is E, because it's a long vowel. I've told you that if a vowel is followed by a colon, that means that it's a long vowel. Okay. So yes, E as in sheep. Next, let's take the next vowel, that is E. Just simply, again, it's a capital letter, is used, not a small letter. So sheep. Then again, we see that O has got a different form, which we are not familiar with. It is O. Next one is as in good. As in good. Okay. Next is, again, that's a small letter. So there is a difference between the short vowel U and the long vowel U, because the long vowel U uses the small letter U. Okay, clear? Is it clear? Okay, so it is U, shoot, and again we have F-O-O-D. How do we say it?
Food.
Food.
Don't pronounce food as good, because good has got the short vowel U and food has got the long vowel U. It is food. The next is A, as in bed. Give me some other examples. Bed.
Bed.
Tent.
Pet. Get all these use the short vowel A letter. Again, don't say it as E, it is A. From now onward, we are looking only at the pronunciation, not at the letter. I've told you earlier that in phonetics, we are concerned only with the pronunciation of the letters, not with the spelling. So we will go for A sound, not E letter. Okay. So when I say E, that means the letter is I. So when I say A, the letter is E.
E.
Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we have an inverted. Next, we have an inverted A, that the pronunciation of that inverted A is a. Okay, a. So we have so many words ending with er. So all those words take the inverted a in its pronunciation, in their pronunciation. For example, teacher. Again, I've told you in the last class that when we use r, if it is not pronounced, if it is not followed by a vowel sound, we leave it unpronounced. Okay, so we don't usually pronounce that er, that r letter in all the words which end with er or or. That is okay. Why we pronounce the words father. We might be pronouncing those words as father, mother, sister, brother, and so on. But the actual pronunciation is father, mother, brother, sister, teacher. So in all those words, we have the pronunciation. The arresting vowel is a, not the consonant r. It is a sound. Again, a as in above, a as in again, a as in another. Again, a as in father, mother, brother, and so on. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we again have a new symbol, that is three followed by a colon. It has to be pronounced. It is the long vowel form of the a sound, not the a sound. Rather, it is the long, prolonged version of a. So we are going to pronounce it as a, as in bird. Give me some other example. P-E-A-R-L.
Early.
Pearl.
Third.
Pearl. Girl.
Heard.
Very good. Heard. See, in all those words, we can again see that there is an R. So in order to compensate for the nose of that R, we often lengthen the quality of the vowel. So we get a or o in so many words whereby we don't pronounce R, as in court. So we don't usually pronounce R. So we prolong the vowel which comes before the letter R. Okay, so we get coat, then bird, then girl. And look, if you check all these words, you can see that there is this R, which is unpronounced. So in order to compensate for that R, we use a long vowel, bird. Okay, it's bird. So it is the prolonged version of A, not A. Again, I'm telling you that it is a prolonged version of A. So we got E, 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 U, U. A, A, A. Then next is O. So O, again, it's not a full circle. It's kind of half circle. So like a C. So a mirror form of, mirror version of C. So when C is followed by, a half circle is followed by a colon, it denotes the long vowel O. Okay. Door. Then Po. In all those words, we get court, C-O-U-R-T. So again, in all these words, we use the long form of O. Okay.
Okay. Here,
next is, again, that's a new symbol for us, even though we pronounce it often. That is, again, that sound is not there in Malayalam. I don't know whether the sound is there in Hindi, but still, we are using that pronunciation often. It is A, as in cat. We don't pronounce cat as cat or Kate, it is A sound. Okay, which is not common in many of the Indian languages. It is A sound. As in cat, as in fan, as in man. Give me some other examples.
Man.
Mat.
Head.
Mat.
Bed.
Lamp.
Lamp.
Very good, very good, very good. Next is, we have a triangle without a base, a kind of thing. I'm simply explaining my own version of the simple. Okay, don't go for that. It is A, simple A, a short vowel A. So we have that A in words like sun, fun, then up.
Cup.
Give me some other examples.
Run. Hut.
What did you say? Hut. Okay, hut. Run. Very good.
But
if you are using H-U-R-T, it is? If it is H-U-R-T, it's hurt.
Hurt.
Again, we have that prolonged version of a sound, as in bird, hurt. So next is A followed by a colon, which is the long form of A, prolonged form of A, which is A, as in pa. Again, that R is not pronounced. So we usually end the word with that vowel, long vowel, A. Pa, then ka.
Ja.
Ka, ja. Again, father. I have told you that example earlier. So father, then dance, castle. All these words have the long vowel A. The next is O. Earlier we saw the long form of O, O, O. That is not a complete circle. It's a kind of mirror version of C. But here we see that it's an O with a tail. So it is on. S-H-O-T, short. S-H-O-R-T is short. That's a better example to understand the difference between O and O. Okay, O and O. Short, short. When you have that R sound coming in between, R letter coming in between, you lengthen the vowel before it, so you'll get O, short. Okay. Shall we move on?
Is it not O, ma'am?
Yeah.
It is not O, it's just simple O.
What about awesome?
Which one?
Awesome.
Awesome. Ah, that's long O. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Shall we move on? Next.
Yes, ma'am.
Again, we have the second classification, which combined the monophthong. It is diphthong. So we have a monophthongs and diphthong. I told you already, vowel phonemes can be divided as monophthongs and diphthongs. You see, if you look at the words, you can see that there are two vowels involved. So that means it's a combination of two vowels. As the name die suggests, it's a combination of two vowels. So rather, we would say that it's a glide from one vowel towards another. It's a movement of one vowel towards another. So look at the diphthongs here. First one is E plus A. So it is ear, as in here, as in near. Okay. You can also give me examples. Clear.
Dear.
Dear. Very good. Next one is A plus. Again, it's not an inverted A. So we will mention A. A plus E. So it is
A.
A. As in weight. Weight.
Hate.
Hate. Late.
Mate.
Mate. Very good.
Great.
So next
great.
Is. Great. Very good. So next is. O plus A. It's O. Okay. It's again O sound. O plus inverted A. Inverted E. That is O-A. Usually we use, usually Indian speakers use long vowels instead of this diphthong. So we often get tourist instead of tourist. It is actually tourist. Tour. I'm going for a tour. We usually say it is tour or tour. Tour. So actually it is tour. Tour. Then P-O-O-R.
Poor.
Poor. Then P-U-R-E.
Pure.
Pure.
Pure. Again, pure. And all these words, we have the diphthong W sound. Okay. Sure. S-U-R-E. Sure.
Minda, Minda.
Sorry? Did you say something? I didn't get that. Okay, next is OE, O plus E. Again, O, it's not the long form. Even though it takes the symbol of the long O, it's simple. It's simply the short O, O plus E, OE, as in boy. Then T-O-Y.
Coin.
Coin, C-O-I-N, coin, S-O-I-L, soil. Then T-O-Y, toy. In all these words, we have the diphthong OE, toy. Next is again, diphthong, which we don't pronounce much, which we don't often use much, but still many words have this diphthong.
Ma'am?
We don't know the correct pronunciation. That's why we don't use it. That is A plus U. How do we say it?
O.
O, O, as in N-O, no. G-O, no. Go. S-H-W, show. Again, we Yuck. Have the O comes in the initial position. Sorry?
Yolk, Y-O-L-K.
A yolk, very good. Ah, okay, very good. Then we have O-C-E-A-N, ocean. Again, we use O sound, ocean. Then we have O coming in the word oats.
Home.
O-A-T-S, it is oats.
Home.
H-O-M-E, home. But in house, we have a different diphthong, but in home, we use O sound. Next, we have A plus A sound, as in hair, T-H-E-R-E.
Share.
T-H-E-R-E is there. S-H-E-R-E, share. T-H-E-R-E, care. Layer. Share. In all these words, we have the combination A and A. Next, we have R plus E combination, that is I. So, we get the pronunciation I in words like my, N-I-G-H-T.
Light,
sky, very good. Try, shy,
shy, bye.
Good. So next, we have sight. Then we have a plus o combination. The diphthong is pronounced as ow, as in cow,
bow,
cow,
bounce,
bounce. House.
Now.
So that's a major difference between home house. And house. In house, we have ow sound, while in home, we have o sound. Okay. That will help you to remember the difference between these two diphthongs. O and ow. So shall we move on? Moving on?
Yes, ma'am.
So yes, please, this is the table which I've taken from your textbook. This table shows you in which all positions they can come. So let's take the first one, that is long E. So it can come in all the three positions. Initial position, medial position, and final position in the words like in words like eat, that there e comes in the initial position. Then the second word read, we have e comes in the middle position. And in the word tea, the long vowel e, the long monophthong e comes in the end position, final position. Second, let's take the second one, it in the initial position, pit in the middle position, and pretty we have e in the final position. But look at a sound. A comes only, the vowel or the monophthong A comes only in the two positions, the first two positions, initial and medial position. It doesn't come in the final position. That means no word ends with the vowel A. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Is the idea clear so that you can understand the rest of the vowels also? Now let's look at the diphthongs. I'll take one example. A. A as in A, it comes in the initial position. In second word, grade comes in the middle position. Grade, look at the last word, stay, where we have A in the final position. But look at the last one, that is ua. Pure, ua. It's the.
Ma'am, actually, what is this initial position and medieval, this middle initial and final position?
It comes in the first position. Look at the word aim. Sorry, let's take the case of aim. So aim, in that word we have the diphthong a in the initial position. That means the word begins with a sound that comes in the that comes as the first syllable or the initial syllable. Look at the second word grade, there we have a comes as the second syllable. Or look at the word, there comes in the middle position. Because we have a D coming after A sound. So that means it comes in the middle position. Is that clear?
Yes.
That means initial means you can say one syllable of, or single syllable. Middle means you can say use in middle of the word.
See, I was not trying to break it up as syllables. Rather, I was trying to tell you that it can come in the initial middle position. That means there can be other sounds which follow it. So look at the word great. Even though it is a second syllable, there is a consonant. There we have an arresting consonant, der sound.
Yes, yes, yes.
Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
So even though there are only two syllables and A comes in the second syllable, there we have an arresting consonant, that is der sound.
Yes, okay. It played.
Ma'am, can't we just take it as the first word, the first alphabet? Will it be wrong?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Ma'am, like A, we have aim, grade, and stay. The last word,
all
stay,
these words are monosyllabic words. Let me tell you that. All these words are monosyllabic words. That is why I've told you, if you cut the word into syllables, you will find it, you might find this confusing.
No, ma'am, without the syllable, if we take aim, it starts with a sound. So
that is exactly
initial,
what I was trying to tell.
Initial. He didn't understand. Yes. That's what I was just.
Okay, fine.
Is it correct, ma'am? And stay because.
It's correct.
Stay because it ends with Y, but stay, you don't pronounce Y. You just say stay. You don't say stay. Maybe that is why.
We don't have that consonant sound at the end of the word.
Y.
Rather, the word ends with the diphthong A, as in stay.
Okay, yes.
So even though we have the spelling, we have an E letter in the spelling of grade, actually the word ends with the consonant sound D.
D, yes.
Okay, is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
No, not to you. The other one.
Yeah, sorry.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So there are monosyllabic words. The first three are all the first three words are monosyllabic words. Next, let's take another example. Okay, sorry.
Ma'am, that means a word we can use any letter, but then what sound it makes, depending on that, we have to use this symbols.
Yes.
Okay, fine.
I told you already that we are only concerned with the pronunciation, not with the letters.
Okay.
So that is why I've told you to first transcribe the word. Only if you transcribe the word that you will understand this small differences. Otherwise, you will get confused. Fine. Even when I say that the word ends with an arresting consonant, you might see, you might feel that, see, the word ends with an letter, with the vowel E letter. E. Okay. Huh. So how can I say that it's a consonant there? So first of all, you have to transcribe the word. Then only you will understand these differences.
Yeah.
Let's take one more example. Let's take the second one. I, as in I'll. So in the word I-S-L-E, when you transcribe the word, you get the transcription I plus L, I and L. Okay, it's clear. If you transcribe the word, you'll get only a vowel and a consonant. That is I plus L, I. Is the idea clear to you? Don't look at the spelling. You don't need to be concerned with this. You don't need to be concerned about the spelling. Just look at the transcription. If you transcribe the word I, you'll get only two letters. One sound is I, it's a vowel or it's a diphthong, while L is a consonant. So we have the word I'll begin with I, that's a diphthong. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Next, take the second word, that is bright. If you transcribe the word again, you will get only three symbols. One is B, that is the initial consonant. Second, we get R sound also, because there R has to be pronounced since it is followed by a vowel sound. So BR, so that means CC. There are two consonants, right?
Yes.
Then we get the diphthong, so it's a vowel. So we get the combination CCV. Then we have another C, that is T. So we get a transcription formula CCVC. Clear? Is the idea clear? Two consonants plus vowel plus a consonant. So if you look at the word, you can see that word comes in the middle position. Okay. Next, let's take the next word, fly. So you get the combination, F is a consonant, C, then L is a consonant. Again, we get another C consonant. So C, C, then Y is a vowel sound there. Even though the letter is a consonant one, the pronunciation is vowel. So we get the combination C, C, V. Again, you can see that the word ends with a diphthong. So it means it can come in the N position as well. So the diphthong I can come in the initial position, it can come in the middle position, it can also come in the end position or final position. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
See, but look at the last one. It is written wrongly here. Ua. It's actually ua. Not u and a, it's actually u and a. I hope you remember it. Ua. As in pure, poor, sure. You remember that? Ua. It is ua sound. Even though it is written wrongly here, it is ua. It's not a, it's actually inverted a. Inverted e, it is ua. So you will not find a word which begins with ua, because it can't come in the initial position. It comes only in the middle and final positions. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Can I move on? Moving on. See, I have written certain words here for you to understand. So I have given the transcription also. Look at the word C. The word ends with the long vowel E. Then again, any. As you can see, the transcription is any. So you just look at the transcription and try to read the words. Then you will understand the difference.
See.
Just go through the words.
Hate.
Is it hate? Did I write the word hate? It is not hate. It is a sound.
Hat.
As in man, hat. Fan. So it is hat. Okay. See, all these are common monophthongs. They're all diphthong. None of the word is a diphthong. You can see that in certain words, R is given brackets, the parenthesis. That means R is not pronounced there. Even though the spelling, in spelling, mm-hmm. we keep that R, it is not pronounced there. That's why I have put that R in parenthesis. Clear?
It's far.
I hope you have gone through
the words.
F-U-R,
far.
F-U-R-S, not far. It is P. The sound is as in girl, as in pearl. Okay. Girl, pearl, okay. Bird.
It's fur.
Okay, ma'am.
Moving on, we will see the transcriptions of some certain diphthongs. Look at the words. Look at the transcription and try to read the words instead of looking the words first.
Pay. Five.
Oh. You finished reading?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Let's take the last one, pure. If you are not using the, do you see that J letter?
Yes, ma'am.
J stands for the consonant sound here. Don't forget that. J, the letter J stands for the symbol here.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you don't use that J there, it becomes pure.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
You simply remove that here from the word, you will get poor. Pure, that's a major difference between pure and poor.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Let's move on.
The previous slide, you had written fair, F-A-I-R. R is not pronounced in that?
Fair, no.
No. Both in the village fair as well as she is fair. In both, R is not pronounced.
Fair.
Village fair. No. Oh. Whenever a word ends with a R sound, it is not pronounced unless it is followed by a vowel sound. If we are saying that the fair is really good, then in that case, you can pronounce that R sound because it is followed by a vowel E.
Okay.
In both F-A-R-E and F-A-I-R, R is not pronounced. As in the case of T-H-E-I-R there and T-H-E-R-E there. I think I've told you that, see, all these words have maintained the spelling, even though we don't pronounce those words ending with certain vowels. We don't pronounce the vowels in those letters, those words which end with E. Example, I've told you, wifey. Chaucer's Canterbury Tales, we will come across many words whereby we see that those words end with some vowels. So we might even think that how can we get a heroic couplet there? Because no words are rhyming. But still, if you consider that those end vowels are pronounced in the old English or Middle English, you will see the difference. You will understand that. So those ending vowels are to be pronounced, even though we don't pronounce it nowadays. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Is it clear to you? So in both F-A-I-R and F-A-R-E, you have the same pronunciation. Just like we have the same pronunciation for T-H-E-R-E and T-H-E-I-R.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. Moving on. Now, try to write down these words. Or you might even tell me which all are the words. One of you can tell me. You want to write it down? You may write down the words. I have given the transcription. You can write down the words. Are you writing?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
When someone finishes, they may read
hoot,
out the word.
Hoot.
Very good.
Hood. Hut. Hot.
Hat.
Hot.
Hate.
It's not hate. Hate
heart.
Has a diphthong.
Hate.
It is hat. No, see. Hate has the diphthong A, the combination A and T. It is hat. Monophthong. Okay.
Then heart.
Spell me the.
No. R is silent.
R is silent. So you get the spelling H A R T. We usually say it as heart, but it's actually heart. R is silence. R is silent there. Next is
hair.
Her.
Here.
H E R.
Her.
Her.
Okay.
Hair.
Hair.
Here.
It's actually here.
Here.
Here and hair.
Shoot.
Short. S-H-O-T, short. How you got? First one is should, S-H-O-U-L-D. S-H-O-R-T. And the last one is S-H-O-T.
S-H-O-T.
Okay. Now I have given some bigger words. This is how you transcribe the words.
Wife.
Wife.
Stomach.
Don't use O sound there. See, even though I've written R, the vowel, you are still pronouncing it as stomach. It is stomach.
Stomach.
Don't forget the stomach.
Fish.
Qualify.
Manage.
Traffic.
Magnify. Traffic.
Never.
Not. Football. Football.
T-set.
Tomcat.
Impossibility.
Impossible language, because that is very important to us. It is language. So we have N sound, we have G sound, language.
Impossibility.
Boisterous.
Yeah.
Youngster.
Another.
Diabolical.
Nearly.
Red riding hood. Incubator.
Inexcusable.
Okay, see, whenever you have this that is inverted R comes in the initial position, you don't usually stress that word. Instead, you say it as another, avoid. So don't try to stress that sound, because it's a weak vowel. So whenever you have a word beginning with the vowel you try to put stress on the next syllable. Avoid, another. Okay, again, that's how you read it. But I'm so happy that you could read all these words. I hope you understood transcription now.
Yeah,
ma'am, please tell me the second last word.
Yes, ma'am. Nice.
Second last one. Which one? Umbrella.
Red.
Red riding hood. Hood.
Thank you, ma'am.
Again, food in the word food, it is the short vowel U, but in the word food, we use the long vowel. Don't forget that. While in F-O-O-T, we use the short vowel U. Okay.
Food.
But in F-O-O-D, it is the long vowel U. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now I'm moving on. So you may write, I think you better write it down. It's a sentence. I've given you certain sentences, three sentences. Try to write down the words. Write down the sentence. And I'll show you the sentence transcription also, so you may compare.
Okay, ma'am.
You all try to read it out. Thank you. Let's see. Okay, you try to write down the sentence.
It is harder.
Is it difficult?
Yes, ma'am.
Little bit, ma'am.
Let's see, trying. You just try. I'll give you time.
Okay.
But the all the sentences are connected. Okay. You're finding it hard just because you're not familiar with the symbols. That is the reason why you are not able to read it.
Something like the earliest phoneticians were the Indian grammarians who wanted
the least phoneticians.
Have you finished writing?
Only one, ma'am.
One sentence.
No, then you take some more time. You write all the sentences. Once you finish it, I'll show you the transcription.
Okay.
I am now Ishan Awasthi.
Sorry? Are you finding it difficult?
Nothing. Difficult, man.
Maybe you're not familiar with the symbols. That's the reason why. Have you gone through the consonant symbols which we discussed in the last class?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Then you will definitely be able to read it.
Can you read it, ma'am?
Let me read. first one I'll read. The earliest phonetics were the Indian grammarians who wanted to preserve what they thought to be the correct pronunciation of Sanskrit.
Sanskrit, yes.
That's right, ma'am.
Okay, next one. Did you write the next one?
Yes,
ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Their natives were religious in that
It was very important to them that their holy scriptures should be pronounced in their traditional way.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking in between.
Okay. Shall I read the last one?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Their accounts of the sound of pattern of Sanskrit are still highly regarded by linguists.
Yes.
Okay, these are the sentences. Is it okay now?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
So this was the transcribed version, and these are the original sentences, the earliest phonetics. See, look at the. In certain places we use the, and in certain places we use the. Why is it so? See, look at the first sentence, the earliest. But look at the third line, the correct pronunciation. So in that case, in the second, the.
After the, it's a vowel, I guess.
So when exactly. So when you have a vowel,
before the vowel
follows the article, the. When a vowel is used after article the, it is to be pronounced as the. When it is followed by a consonant, the same, the becomes the. Is it clear?
Okay,
the article will become the. Okay, that's why we have the in the initial, in the first sentence, in the initial, initial position of the first sentence, and the third sentence, it is the. Because it is followed by a consonant sound. Yeah, be correct. Because ka is a consonant. The man. But he says apple. Because apple is
the sound. The people.
You all have the same problem?
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know if the person sees unmute her.
Christy, please mute your microphone.
Let that.
Okay, ma'am.
Ma'am, you're on mute, ma'am.
Oh, clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Sounds are coming.
So now we are going to discuss the classification of vowels. In case of consonants, we had a classification based on the vibration of vocal cords, but that classification is not applicable here, just because all vowels are
voiced.
Okay, so here the classification is going to be based on the tongue, mainly on the tongue. The first one is the part of the tongue that is raised. And earlier when we discussed the organs of speech, we saw that the tongue can be divided as tip,
blade, front, and back part.
Remember that? Tip, blade, front, and back. The front part is opposite to the hard palate, and the back part lies opposite to the soft palate. And the second classification is based on, so the first classification is based on the part of the tongue that is raised. Okay, so again, I have told you one more point, that all the vowels are produced without any obstruction in the oral cavity, or the oral passage of the air is unobstructed in the case of vowels. Okay, do you remember that?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
So when the air is released, there is no friction at all. There is no pressure at all. So again, we see that the tongue never touches the roof of the mouth. There is no obstruction formed in the case of vowels. So the part of the tongue that is raised. Anyway, in order to produce sound, we have to move our tongue. So first classification is based on the part of the tongue that is raised. Which part is raised? That is, our tongue is divided as front, back, and central part. Central part is the part which comes in between the front and back part. Okay. So the part of the, which part of the tongue is raised, as what decides the first classification. Second is the height to which the tongue is raised. Height means when you produce a vowel sound, of course your tongue will be moving towards the roof of the mouth. If it lies flat, almost flat, then you can say that it is the open position. Then if it moves a little bit, you will see that it is half open. If it is almost close to the roof of the mouth, it is half closed. It's very close to the roof of the mouth, it is closed. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Then the position of the lips. That means whether the lips take rounded shape or unrounded shape. For example, when you produce certain vowels like oo, lips will be round. But when you produce certain vowels like e, the lips will be unrounded. So these are the three classifications in case of vowels. First one is based on the part of the tongue that is raised. So here we are going to divide the tongue as front part, then central part, and the back part. And second classification is based on the height of the tongue. So how far the tongue moves. If it is very close to the roof of the mouth, anyway, it never touches the roof of the mouth, then it becomes consonant. If it touches the roof of the mouth, again, we'll see that an obstruction is formed in the oral passage, so it can't be called vowel. Is the idea clear? Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So if it is very close to the roof of the mouth, they are closed vowels. If they are half close to the roof of the mouth, they are half closed vowels. Then if it is half open, between half closed and open, it is half open. And if it is moves a little bit, it is open. To look at the position of, this is the tongue position. So here we will see the tongue position. The first part shows the front, central, and back part of the tongue. Front, central, and back part. If it moves a little bit, it is open. If it is in halfway, it's half open. If it is close to the roof of the mouth, it is half closed. If it is very close to the roof of the mouth, it is closed vowel. It's a closed vowel. So that classification is based on three parts: low, mid, and high.
Closed vowel example, ma'am?
Sorry?
Closed vowel example, ma'am?
I'm going to give you examples. Yeah, I've written the examples also. A, E, U, O. Now we'll see the classifications, then you will understand it better. Because these, what to say, the divisions are already subtle. You won't be able to see it with your tongue. These differentiations are very subtle.
Yeah, if you...
Sorry?
Mia, please mute your phone.
See, these are very
subtle. Okay, ma'am, carry on.
So you won't be able to feel it with your tongue. Okay, in case of consonants, at least when you say bilabial, you'll be able to understand it. Because you feel that when you pronounce it, you use both lips. But in case of vowels, it's very difficult to feel it with your tongue. Because the differences are very subtle. Let's look at the friend vowels first. Friend vowels means? What do you mean by friend vowels?
Produced with the front part of tongue.
The front part of the tongue will be moved when you produce these vowels. The front vowels in English are the short
vowel. Extra part of the tongue.
The first front part of the tongue will be moved. So we have the short vowel E and the long vowel E. Then we have A and A sound. All these four are front vowels. And I have given you the three-tone labeling of each of these vowels. The first one, E. That means it's a friend vowel. As you can see from the picture, it's a close vowel because it's very close to the roof of the mouth. Can you see that? See, when you produce all the four words, you can see that it is marked in the friend part. All these vowels are marked in the friend part. The parts where we see the mark to the part of the tongue. Is the diagram clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
So we have E as friend, the CTM labeling of E as friend. It's a close unrounded vowel. Close means it's very close to the roof of the mouth. Can you see that? It's very close to the roof of the mouth. Then it's an unrounded vowel. That you can easily feel. It's an unrounded vowel. When you produce E, your lips do not take round shape. So we classify E as friend, close, unrounded vowel. Then look at the short vowel E. It's a centralized friend, half-close, unrounded vowel. Why it is centralized friend, half-close, unrounded vowel?
Tongue is not much raised.
It is not much risen. So centralized friend, half-close, it's half-close, but still it takes a central position. So centralized friend, half close, the central has nothing to do with the part of the tongue. Okay, that shows only the position. Centralized friend, half close, unrounded vowel. Next, we will see A. It's friend, unrounded vowel between. You can't completely call A as half close or half open. So it is between half close and half open. By looking at the position, friend, it's a friend vowel. It's an unrounded vowel, but it comes between, comes in between half close and half open position. It's clear?
Yeah, ma'am.
Look at the last one, A. It's a friend, unrounded vowel between the half open and open. It is neither open nor completely half open. It again comes in between open and half open. So all these four vowels are unrounded. Okay, moving on. See, I have taken one example. So look at the first long vowel E, as in beat. Which all positions it can come? It can come in accented position and as well as in unaccented positions. Accented and unaccented means stressed positions and unstressed positions. Clear? So let's take the first example, believe. So there are two syllables. Be and leave, believe. So in that word, we have stress falling on the second syllable where we have the long vowel E. Clear?
Clear.
Is the idea clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
So look at all the words. Seizure, machine, police, repeat, diabetes. So in all these words, we can see that stress falls on the syllable where we have the long form of E, that is E, long vowel E. Let's take the second case, that is which words we have this E comes in the unaccented position. Decrease, So there, even though you have a long vowel in the second syllable, the stress falls on the. Where do we have the stress? Decrease. How many syllables are there in the word decrease?
Two syllables.
Do we have the stress? At D and crease. There are only two syllables. So where do we have the stress falling on?
After D.
Second syllable.
If it comes in the second syllable, we can't say that it comes in an unaccented position. Because in the second syllable, we have the long vowel E. But here it is written that E can also come in unaccented position. So that means stress naturally falls in the
first
position. Of course. So it has to be, it is not pronounced as decrease. Rather, it is to be pronounced as decrease. Okay.
Decrease.
But if you are using the same word as a verb, you can see that the stress falls on the second syllable. So when you are using it as a noun, there was a sudden decrease. So in that case, you have the stress on the second stress in the first syllable. And if the word is used as a verb, it decreased. So then you can see that the stress falls on the second syllable. Clear?
Okay, clear, ma'am.
Okay. Now it can come in both the position, but only thing is that if it is used as a noun, sorry,
repeat that one more time, the difference.
See, sometimes certain, there are certain words which can be used both as nouns and verbs. For example, advice. I advised him, I gave him a piece of advice. In both ways you can use the same word. Here also we can say that decrease can be used as a verb while decrease is a noun. There was a sudden decrease. There was a sudden decrease in the price. So in that case, decrease is used as a noun. So we have the stress falling on the first syllable. But if I say, if I use the same word as a verb, as in the example, it decreased suddenly. The temperature decreased suddenly. So in that case, I have used decrease as a verb.
So okay.
We can say that the stress falls on the second syllable.
Second syllable.
Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
So you can also, you might have to add that in this case, decrease, the stress falls on the first syllable just because it's a noun. Okay?
Okay.
Economist. Again, economist. It's not economist, it's economist. Again, we have stress. The stress falls on the second syllable, not in the first syllable, where we have the long vowel E. Secrete. Second syllable uses the long vowel E while the stress falls on the first syllable, say. Secrete. It is secrete. So the stress falls on say. Secrete. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So the use of E in unaccented positions is, however, becoming less frequent. That is because you have this tendency to use vowel E instead of E, long vowel E. So we can say that it can come in the initial position. So in the first set of words, we saw that it can come in the accented position as well as in unaccented position. Second set of words, we'll see that it comes in the initial position, it comes in the middle position, and it also comes, it can also come in the end position or final position. So look at the first three set of words. Is, eel, and eve. In all these words, we can see that the long vowel E comes in the initial position. Right? Look at the second set of words. Seat, belief, breed, people. If you look at the word, you see that there is a consonant precede the word, right? There is a consonant precedes the word. So seat, in the word seat, we have C, the combination here is C, V, C. That is consonant, vowel, consonant. So we have the vowel that is coming in the middle position.
Middle position.
Clear?
Yes.
Again, if you take the second one, belief. Belief. So what is the combination there? C V C V C. So there are two syllables. C V C V C. But there also we see that L E, the second syllable, the long vowel E comes in between two consonants, right? So that means it comes in the middle position. It is neither the initial position or the end position. It comes in between the between two consonants. So we say that it comes can come in the middle position. Look at the last word, key. Key. We don't have any arresting consonant there. Instead, we have the word ending with the long vowel E. So we have the combination CV. So here the V represents the long vowel E. Okay?
Okay.
Clear?
Yes.
I took only one example. You will see all these classifications, classifications like accented, unaccented, the different positions that it can take. All these are given in your textbook for each of these vowels. Okay. Second one, the same example, accented and unaccented position. It can come in accented position as well as an unaccented position. Look at the first word, absent. See, again, it is adjective. So if you are using the verb of absent, the stress position changes. For example, he is absent. In that case, it is the stress falls on the first syllable, that is a. Okay?
Okay.
So if you are using absent as a verb, he absented himself from the class. He absented. There you can see that stress falls on the second syllable. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that is why it is specifically mentioned that absent is used as an adjective. You have this accent falls on the first syllable. Then again, we can see that a can come in the first two positions, that is initial and medial position. No word ends with the vowel a sound. You won't find a word ending with a. But it can come in initial and medial position. But it will never come in the end position or final position. Clear?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we are going to see the back vowels. So back vowels. First classification was based on the position. The part of the tongue which is raised. Which is based on that, we have front vowels, back vowels, and central vowels. So look at the second classification. Back vowels. So we have five back vowels. Which all are the five back vowels? Back vowel means when you produce these vowels, the back part of the tongue will be raised. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, we have five back vowels. Which all are they?
Oo.
O.
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 O and R. For two vowels, we have the prolonged version also, except in the case of R. So and R. So this is how you classify each of these vowels. First one, the long vowel is a back closed rounded vowel. Because when you produce the sound produce the vowel sound your lips take a round shape. Rounded vowel. Then it's a back vowel because when you produce the vowel sound, your back part of the tongue is raised. It's a closed vowel because the tongue moves towards the roof of the mouth. Though it doesn't touch the roof of the mouth, it is very close to the roof of the mouth. So we'll say that it's a back closed rounded vowel. Clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
next is ma'am. Centralized again. In a central position, centralized back rounded vowel just above half close. Then third one is O. You may even write back rounded vowel just above half close. If that centralized gives you some confusion, you may avoid the term adjective. So you better go for back rounded vowel just above half close. Then we have OS, back rounded vowel between half open and half close. If you look at the diagram, you will understand. Then next is O, back rounded vowel just above the open position. Then we have R, open and rounded vowel. Except R, all the other vowels are rounded. Clear?
Clear, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Let's move on. Then we are taking one example from here also. Let's take the long vowel U. So it's a back closed rounded vowel. Let's see the stress. Let's look at the kind of stress it takes. It can come in accented position as well as in unaccented position. Look at the word beautiful. So in beautiful, you have stress folds on the first syllable. How many syllables are there in the word beautiful?
Three syllables.
So here we see that the stress folds on the first syllable, that is view. It's beautiful. So we have that long vowel O comes in the initial position. Initial position means it comes in the initial syllable rather. Not initial position, initial syllable. So stress folds on the initial syllable. Look at the second set of example.
Ma'am, have you stopped sharing the screen? We can't see your screen.
Yes,
no,
ma'am.
No, ma'am. We can't see.
No, ma'am. It is.
Can see?
No.
Yes, ma'am.
We can see.
No,
we can see, ma'am.
Yes, we can see. No problem.
No, having stopped sharing.
We can't see, ma'am.
By that, stop.
You have to pin the video for you to see it.
Till a few minutes back, we can see, but in between, somebody started sharing their screen. By then, we can't see, yes, ma'am. Now it's visible, ma'am.
And in that case, why is it some of you are seeing?
Because we have pinned your presentation.
Now we can see.
So I was explained the case of the long vowel U, the close rounded vowel U. It can come in the accented position as well as an unaccented position. Let's take the first example, beautiful. In the three syllable to word beautiful, we have the stress folds on the first syllable, that is bu. Okay, bu means b, then ya, the consonant sound ya, then we have the long vowel U. So the word is to be pronounced as beautiful. The stress folds on the first syllable. It doesn't fall on the second or third syllable. Rather, it folds on the first syllable. Beautiful. It is not beautiful or it is not beautiful. It's beautiful. So it means the stress folds on the first syllable. The syllable whereby we have the long vowel O. Clear?
Clear.
Yes, ma'am.
Next is deluge. Again, the stress, even though we have that long U in the second syllable, the stress folds on the first syllable. It is deluge. So the stress folds on da instead of la. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, now we will see the positions that the long vowel U can take. It can come in initial position as in ooze, oobs and oo. Then medial position as in fruit, the combination is CVC, fruit. Then the final position, true. The combination is CCV, true. Clear? True. CCV means that two consonants followed by the vowel. CCT is a consonant. R is a consonant. R has to be pronounced since it is followed by a vowel. So we get the combination CCV. Clear?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Moving on.
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we will see the central vowel. Central vowel means the central part of the tongue will be raised when you produce these three vowels. Which are the three vowels? A, and A. Okay, A. So we have a prolonged form of one short vowel, that is A and A. A as in father and A as in girl or pearl. Then we have A as in sun, fun. So these three vowels come under the classification of central vowels.
Central vowels.
And they are called central vowels. Then look at the three-term labeling of these three vowels. First one is central unrounded vowel between open and half open. Look at the position it takes. If you look at the diagram, you can see that it comes in between open and half open. Can't be completely called open or can't be completely called half open. It takes a middle position. Again, it's a central vowel because central part of the tongue is raised. It's an unrounded vowel because when you produce a sound, your lips are not rounded.
Rounded.
Clear? Okay. So, is central unrounded vowel between half closed and half open. Again, that you can see from the picture. You can read from the picture. Last one is, which is a central unrounded vowel just below half open. It is just below half open. Unlike the case of it's between half closed and half open. Right? Is just below half open. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now let's take the case of one vowel. Here also comes in an accented position as well as an unaccented position, accented and unaccented positions. So first one is burden. Look at the word burden. It has got two syllables. The first syllable is bur. R is not truly pronounced since it is followed by the consonant sound d. So it is burden. So the stress falls on the first syllable, that is a, bur. There we have the long vowel a. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
It's the bisyllabic words with stress on the first syllable. This the first syllable has got the long vowel a. Look at the second example, commerce. Commerce. So we stress not on ma, rather we stress on the first syllable commerce. Ma has got the long vowel a, but still the stress falls on the first syllable. It's commerce. Forward. Forward. There also we have stress falling on the first syllable, not on the second syllable, where we have the long vowel a. Clear?
Yeah.
Yeah, next, you will see the positions it can take. You can take all the three positions. So, in the first example, early, we have a comes in the initial position because the combination is, there we have two syllables. The combination is V, C, V. Second is surly. So, we have a consonant coming before the long vowel a. So, the combination is C, V,
C.
C, again V. Surly, it has got two syllables, right? Surly. TV, CV. The last one is per. R is not pronounced. So we get the combination CCV. Per is a consonant sound. Per is a consonant sound while a is a vowel sound. So R is not pronounced. So we use a long vowel a sound there.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Moving on, now we will see the classification of diphthongs. Earlier we were looking at the classification of vowels, monophthongs. Now we will see the classification of diphthongs. Again, diphthong, as you know, it's a vowel glide. It's a combination of two vowels. Then there are eight diphthongs in English. It's a either you remember the definition, it's a vowel glide, or you remember the definition, it's a movement of one vowel towards another. Okay, now we have eight diphthongs which we have already discussed. There are eight diphthongs which can be classified as closing diphthongs and centering diphthongs. So closing diphthongs means tongue will be very close to the roof of the mouth. So there is this movement of certain vowels towards a closed vowel. Clear? I told you that it's a movement of one vowel towards another. Diphthong. As a movement of one vowel towards another, it's a combination of two vowels. So we have two vowels here, thereby one vowel moves towards another vowel. So in case of closing diphthongs, there are five closing diphthongs. So in case of closing diphthongs, we see that a vowel will be moving towards a closed vowel. Closed vowel means, what do you mean by a closed vowel?
When the tongue is just toward the...
Tongue is raised towards the roof.
When the tongue is very close to the roof of the mouth, it is called a closed vowel. So E and U, both are closed vowels. You take the first five vowels, A, I, O, E, O and AU. All these are closing diphthongs because E and U are closed vowels. So in the first three set, we in the first set we see that there are three vowels, three diphthongs, A, I and O, E. A, A and O are vowels which are moving towards the closed vowel E. So they're called closing diphthongs. In the second case, in case of the second set of diphthongs, that is O and AU, we see that A and A are vowels moving towards the closed vowel U. That classification is based on the height to which the tongue is raised. That means there are all these five vowels, five diphthongs are moving towards two closed vowels, E and U. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now let's take the second classification, centering diphthong. So central vowel, what do you mean by central vowel? What is the central vowel?
Produced by involvement of central part of tongue.
The central part of the tongue will be moved. So we can see that E, A and U are vowels which are moving towards the central vowel A. So A is the central vowel and E, A and U move towards the central vowel A. Then we get the central diphthong, centering diphthong. Clear? Is the definition clear? So we have five closing diphthongs and...
No, again, repeat it, madam.
Sorry?
Repeat it, madam.
You want me to repeat the definition again?
Yes, madam.
Okay, closing diphthongs. I hope you recall the closing vowels, closed vowels. Closed vowel is a vowel which is, during the production of which the tongue is very close to the roof of the mouth. Okay. Anyway, the tongue never touches.
Okay, madam.
Is the roof of the mouth, since that means obstruction. So when the tongue is very close to the roof of the mouth, we call that vowel close vowel. Okay. And there are five close. Again, you also have to remember the definition of a diphthong. Diphthong is the movement of one vowel towards another. It's a vowel glide. Glide means movement. Glide, movement of one vowel towards another. So it's a combination of two vowels basically. Take the case of A. A is a combination of A and E. So A is a vowel which moves towards another vowel E. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
It means movement.
Yes, ma'am.
So then E is a closed vowel. That means when you produce the vowel sound E, the tongue is very close to the roof of the mouth. So when A moves towards that E, which is a closed vowel, we call it a closing diphthong. Similarly, O is another closed vowel. Then we have A, the vowels A and A move towards this closed vowel U. Then we get another set of closing diphthongs. So E and U are closed vowels. So when we have these other vowels moving towards this E and U, we call them closing diphthongs. Is it clear now?
Yes, madam. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
And the second classification is based on the part of the tongue.
Centering.
That means the A is a central vowel. So we see that E, A and U are vowels which move towards the central vowel A. So we get the centering diphthongs. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Clear? Okay. Now we will see this movement. This movement can be represented using this diagram. Okay, E and U. Look at the vowels E and U. They are closed vowels because they are very close to the roof of the mouth. Anyway, we can't have a classification like semi-closing vowels. So we better call it closing diphthongs. Because E and U are close, very close to the, are close to the roof of the mouth. So when the other vowels move towards this E and U, we call them closing diphthongs. And look at the vowel A, it's a central vowel. Because when you produce the sound A, the central part of the tongue is raised. So when other vowels move towards this A, we call them centering diphthongs. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. Now closing diphthongs. That's a diagram that shows the movement of vowels towards the closing diphthong, movement of vowels towards the vowel E. Then we will take this example of A. So let's take the example of I. I either identity. So look at the word either. Either can also be pronounced as either, which is American actually. Either, in the word either, we have stress on the first syllable. How many syllables are there in the word either?
Two syllables.
There are, it's a two bisyllabic word. So we have the stress falling on the first syllable I, where we have the diphthong I, either. Okay, but look at the second word, identity. Even though we have the word beginning with a diphthong I, the stress falls on the second syllable. But it's again a polysyllabic word. How many syllables are there?
Four syllables.
It's a four syllable the word. It's a polysyllabic word. But the stress falls on the second syllable. Even though I, the diphthong comes in the initial position. Right? Identity. We don't say it is identity. It's actually identity. Idea. Priority. Advertise. Qualify. In all these words, we see that the stress doesn't fall on the syllable where we have the diphthong I. Rather, it falls on some other syllables. But in the other set of words, decline, trier, saliva, benign, icicle, in all these words, we see that the stress falls on the syllable whereby we have the diphthong I. Okay?
Okay.
IELTS. Okay. Again, initial position can come in the initial position as in IELTS, second position as in design, then final position as in by. IELTS, design, in the word IELTS, we have I comes in the initial position. In the word design, we have I comes in the middle position. Then in the word by, we have I comes
in the final position.
Okay, moving on. Closing diphthongs. Again, there's a diagram. I'm picking one example. Around, au. Au occurs in initial, medial and final position. It can come in all the three positions. It can come in accented position as well as in unaccented position. Accented position can be shown using the example around. Around, boundary, groundnut, surround, scoundrel. In all these words, we have the stress falls on the syllable whereby we have this au. But in the, it can also come in unaccented position as in anyhow. In anyhow, we have that au comes in the third syllable, but still the stress falls on the first syllable, any, a sound, okay? Anyhow, the stress falls on any, though, stress comes in the initial position, even though we have that au comes in the end position, the stress doesn't fall on the final syllable. Clear?
Clear.
Again, foundation. Clear. In that word also, we have stress in the second syllable, though au comes in the first syllable. Okay? It can also come in initial, medial and final position using the examples oust, bounty and bow. Clear?
Yes.
Clear? Okay. Centering diphthong, ear and air. I'm taking one example, ua. All these are taken from your textbook only. Furious, then influence. In the word furious, it's furious. Okay, it's not furious, it's furious. In the word furious, the stress falls on the first syllable where we have the diphthong ua. Then look at the second word, influence, ua. Again, we have that ua comes in the second syllable, but the stress falls on the first syllable, that is in, influence. Again, endure. Again, the stress falls on a second syllable where we have ua. But in the case of tortuous, we have stress falling on the first syllable. It's not on the second syllable where we have that ua. The diphthong ua comes. But it can come only in the middle and final position. It never comes in the initial position. As in the example, fluent. There comes in the middle position. But in cure, it comes in the final position or end position. Clear? Is that clear? Uva never comes in the initial position, unlike the other vowels, other diphthongs that we saw. Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Next is a very important thing, suprasegmental features. So, do you think pronunciation can convey all the sense that you want to convey?
No, ma'am.
No.
If you have correct pronunciation, will you be able to convey the sense as such? No. There are certain things matters, and those things are called the supra segment. incidental features. That means there are some features which are superimposed on the utterance of speech. Now, spoken languages, along with pronunciation, we have to consider certain things. And those certain things are called supra-segmental features, like stress. If you want to make a statement into a question, if you want to convert a statement into a question, you naturally use a rising intonation. So that will naturally become a question. Okay, you are listening, right? You are listening. If I'm just making I'm using a falling intonation, that definitely sound like a statement. In order to make my sentence sound like a question, I have to use a different intonation. So that means I can convey my sense using other things also. And those other things are called the supra-segmental features. The features that are superimposed on the spoken language, they are called the supra-segmental features. And the common supra-segmental features are stress that we have seen. In all the words, we were discussing the examples using stress. Stress, then tone, rising tone, falling tone, then duration or syllable. So all these things matter. Syllable, then tone, then stress, all these come under supra-segmental features. Sometimes even nasalization also come under the category. So let's see. In order to make your communication more effective, you have to consider the supra-segmental features. You have to use them in the sense that you want to convey. So let's first start with accent. Earlier we saw RP, received pronunciation, that is an accent. So accent means you are giving emphasis or stress on a particular part of something. Then again, it is used to give stress. For example, I'm taking an example, important and important. If you don't give the stress correctly, if you don't give the accent correctly, definitely it will sound different. Because important, both the words are adjective, right? Important and important. So if you are giving stress to the first syllable for the word important, it would sound like important, right? Am I right?
Ma'am. Yes.
They try to give stress in the first syllable for the word important, then it would definitely say important. Then naturally, it would become important instead of important. So important has to be pronounced as important. The stress has to be given to the second syllable. But in the case of important, the stress should be given to the first syllable. If you try to change the stress to the second syllable, if you try to give the stress to the second syllable, it would sound like important instead of important. Clear? This shows you the difference between the stress. These two examples. If you give a wrong stress to a syllable, definitely that sound would, the word would sound different. Okay?
Okay.
The red part, the red letters show the part whereby we gave stress. Now, syllable division for stress. In order to understand stress, first of all, you have to divide the word into different syllables. I have taken certain examples. Again, these are taken from your textbook. Pelican has three syllables. You can divide the word as pelican. Then Peter has two syllables. You divide the word as Peter. Then philosophy has four syllables. Philosophy. Then how would you divide the word? Usually, you divide the word by considering the vowels and consonants. The only criterion is that it should have a vowel in it. Every syllable should have a vowel in it. Okay.
Okay.
So these words can also be divided as pel, e, can. Then pel, e, can. Because these divisions are possible because each of this syllable constitutes a vowel, contains a vowel. So these divisions are also possible. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Similarly, ability can be divided as usually we go for the division A, B, E, T. But these versions are also possible. Ability. Then A, B, E,
T. That means both are correct, ma'am.
Both are correct. Most often.
Okay.
But you can't have a syllable using a consonant. Using only consonants. So these are the guidelines that would help us. As far as possible, but still you can follow certain guidelines. As far as possible, start a syllable with a consonant. If there is one, differ. Okay, better than going for differ plus a, you go for D plus fur, because it begins with a consonant. Second syllable also begins with a consonant. prefer instead of going for prefer. Clear?
Yes, yes, yes. Then okay. We can read this D-I-F, prefer.
You can even go for pref plus er, but better go for pref plus fer if there is a consonant. If you can start a word, if you can start a syllable with a consonant, always go for it.
Okay.
Okay. So, then two-syllable words, three-syllable words, four-syllable words, five-syllable words, examples are given. Never. Fallacy is a three-syllable word. Fundamental is a four-syllable word. Electricity is a five-syllable word. Then anthropological, responsibility, they're all six-syllable words. These are given for you to understand the syllable division. Clear?
Okay.
Then, how would you understand prominence? Which syllable is prominent? How would you understand it? First is based on the loudness, how loud you are. When you pronounce this syllable, one syllable will be heard more prominent than the rest of the syllable. So loudness matters. Then pitch change. So sometimes you give emphasis to certain syllables so that you can show contrast. So pitch change also matters when you stress a syllable. For example, usually we don't stress words like her, she and all. But if you really want to stress those, if you want to show emphasis, you can stress those words. So that means, for example, it is she who told me. That shows a that shows the emphasis that you gave to the pronoun she. Usually this she is not stressed, but in order to emphasize that pronoun, you can use it, she. So pitch change. But often the pitch changes when you, it is on this particular syllable that pitch changes. If you are using a falling syllable or falling intonation, it is on this particular syllable that this pitch change happens. That you will see later when I, when we discuss falling and rising intonation. Then quality and quantity of vowel. Quality of vowel means if you have a different vowel, for example, tata, t-tata. So if you are, you are using a vowel more than e, but in between, if you use an e vowel, that will be heard more prominent than the other same vowel. Tata, t-tata. Clear? Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, okay.
For example, then we have the length of the vowel also matter. Sometimes, for example, you often tend to stress long vowels more than short vowels. For example, police. In that word, the stress folds on the second syllable because it carries the long vowel. Often, this length of the vowel also matters. Okay? So these are the important factors. These are the factors that are responsible for prominence. Prominence means which stress the... which syllable is heard more prominent than the other syllables. This comes off, this criteria often are often applicable to polysyllabic words. Okay? Because okay. Monosyllabic words do not carry different stress because there is only one particular syllable and the stress always falls on that syllable. This criteria becomes important when you have trisyllabic or polysyllabic words. Yes. Is it clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Moving on, ma'am. Levels of stress. So we have primary stress. Primary stress means the syllable which carries the stress. Okay, the syllable which is heard more prominent than the other syllables, which is heard most prominent. That is called the primary stress. The syllable which carries more stress than the other syllables is said to have primary stress. Secondary stress means the next level of stress. That means the syllable which carries more stress than the other syllables. Clear?
Mm-hmm.
Primary stress carries the maximum stress. Secondary stress, as the name suggests, carries, or a non-tonic or rhythmic stress carry the second level of stress.
Okay, ma'am.
I'll give you the example of examination. If you look at the word examination, which syllable is heard more prominent? Or which syllable is heard the most prominent?
Nation.
Examination.
Nation. Nation.
The syllable, right? There are, how many syllables are there in the word examination?
Five syllables.
There are five syllables.
Five.
So the stress falls on the second last syllable, which is ne. Okay. Right? So ne carries primary stress. And which syllable is heard next to ne? Examination.
Second syllable.
It's a second syllable. Examination. Examination. So you hear ik with the second level of stress. So we can say that it carries non-tonic or rhythmic stress. Because the word begins with ik. That's why you understood the word as examination. So even though ne carries the primary stress, the secondary stress, the second level of stress falls on the first syllable, that is ig. Examination.
Okay, okay.
That is why we have the stress mark given below the word. That means it carries the rhythmic stress or non-tonic stress. Otherwise, it is superscripted. But here it is given below just to show that it carries the second level of stress. Again, this level of stress is applicable only to polysyllabic words. But all the other words are said to have are said to be unstressed. Ne carries the maximum stress, which is the primary stress, and it carries the non-tonic or rhythmic stress. Because it is heard more prominent than the other syllables except ne. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Clear? Can I move on?
Yes, ma'am.
Then look at the words. We have words with stress on different syllables. First, we will take the examples of bisyllabic words. So, a lot of words with stress in the, a lot of bisyllabic words with stress on the first syllable are given. Able, lesson, instant, subject, almost, fortune, interest, welcome, answer, govern, paper, wisdom, awkward, honest, question, woman, business, husband, second, allow. In all these words, we can see that stress falls on the first syllable. But look at the second group of words. Above, become, event, instead, address, between, exchange, myself, admit, defense, fence, perhaps, advance, degree, forbid, suggest, appear, entire, forget, towards. All these words have stress on the second syllable. They're all, again, bisyllabic words with stress on the second syllable. Clear?
Clear, ma'am.
Then we have the next set of words, which are trisyllabic words or words with three syllables with stress on the first syllable. Absolute, character, memory, properly, advertise, delicate, as it goes on. Then words of three syllables with stress on the second syllable, as in the case of adventure, consider, encourage, familiar, already, continue, essential, immediate, another, decision, example, important, commercial, develop, existence, tobacco, comparison, direction, expensive, and tomorrow. Okay. Then three syllabled words with primary stress on the third syllable. Comprehend, disappear, disappoint, domineer, employee, engineer, introduce, recommend, represent, reproduce. See, look at these words. We have stress on the last syllable. I hope you know how to read it now. Is it clear? Do I need to explain all the rest of the words?
No, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, is it fine? Categorize, melancholy, temperament, corrugated, commentary, territory. In all these words, we have, they're all words with four syllables with stress on the first syllable. Then we have words of four syllables with primary stress on the second syllable. Hypocrisy, philosophy, deficiency, degenerate, intelligent, reciprocal. Then emancipate, particular, thermometer, felicitate, ridiculous, manipulate, conspiracy, reversible, democracy. That's how it goes. Then we have four syllable words with primary stress on the third syllable. Advantageous, apparatus, correspondent, disobedient, independence, semolina. That's how it goes. Clear? Then we have some other examples are also given. Incorrigible, there are five-syllabled words with stress on the second syllable. Then we have five-syllabled words with stress on the third syllable. Cosmopolitan, philosophical. Usually we say it as philosophical. Similarly, we psychological, we pronounce it as psychological instead of psychological. The stress falls on la. Then the pronunciation also changes. Okay. Similarly, philosophical, we usually say it is philosophical instead of philosophical. But when you change the stress, you can see the pronunciation also changing. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Words of six syllables with primary stress on the fourth, autobiography, meteorological, then originality, characterization, experimentation. So now we have seen a lot of words with a stress coming in first, second or third syllable. So now we need to know the rules. Why certain words have stress on the fourth syllable and why do we have stress on first or second syllable for certain words? So you, if you want to know the rules, certain rules are given here. So sometimes the part of speech decide the stress. For example, in case of this also I have told you earlier, absent, absent and absent. So if it is a noun or adjective, for bisyllabic words, the stress falls on the first syllable. For bisyllabic words, if it is a verb, the stress falls on the second syllable. Clear? Normal case. That's why we have absent. The word absent has got stress in the first syllable when it is used as a noun or adjective. But if it is used as a verb, the stress moves to the second syllable. Similarly, we have the example contact. Context certificate. We usually say it is context certificate just because it is used as an adjective. He is known for his good contact. Again, that is used as a noun, so the stress falls on the first syllable. But if it is used as a verb, the program was conducted in a very good manner. So that in that case, the same word is used, but the stress changes to the second syllable because it is a verb. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So sometimes the grammatical function of words determine the stress. But again, we have other set of words. We have a few set of words which are based on the derivation, the process of derivation. Derivation means when you keep on adding certain things, the stress keeps on changing. Derivation means you are adding suffixes. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
You will study more about suffixes and prefixes in the coming blocks. So look at the first word, academy. So the stress comes in the second syllable. Then when you have, when you add IC, again the stress changes to the third syllable, academic. Then if you are adding, if you are, when you are converting it into a noun and you are adding IAN to the word, you will see that the stress falls on the
academician.
Not E, it is me. Me. Third syllable. Mission. Third syllable. So, no. Fourth syllable, academician. Isn't it the fourth syllable? A, ca, de, mi, shen.
Five. Oh.
There are five syllables for the word and the stress falls on? Which syllable?
This third syllable,
not
third.
De. Academician. Which syllable it is? What about others?
Fourth one.
It is the fourth one. Don't you get that? It is
yes,
A. Ka is the second syllable. Da is the third syllable. Ma is the fourth syllable. Academician. Is it clear
okay.
Now?
Okay,
the next is Democrat. It is Democrat. Then democracy, second syllable. Democratic, third syllable. So when you keep on adding certain suffixes, you can see that the stress also changing. Stress keeps on changing. Okay? So sometimes when you add suffixes, the stress changes. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Next. Then you can also see that certain compound words take stress on the first syllable or the first part of the word, and noun phrases will carry stress on both the parts. Do you know the difference between a compound word and noun phrase?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
So compound word is a combination of two words which will have a meaning different from the two words which were combined. But in the case of noun phrase, which means both words, you get a meaning related to both the words. For example, if you are saying that it is a white house, that means the house is painted white. So you give stress on both the parts, white and house. It is a white house. This is a dark room. So you give stress on both the parts because it's a noun phrase. That means the room is very dark. So you are using dark as the adjective there. Similarly, you are using white as the adjective there. So you get the word white and house. They're both the words carry equal prominence. But in the case of compound word, you add two words and you sometimes you come up with a completely new meaning, or you get a meaning that might be slightly different from the root word. For example, White House. The president of America lives in the White House. So there you stress only the first part, White House. Okay? The difference is that it is not a noun phrase. Rather, it means the official residence of the American president. Is the idea clear?
Yes.
Similarly, dark room. So if you are using it as a compound word, that means you are meaning, you are trying to tell you the room which is used for washing the photographs. If you are simply saying that it's a dark room, that you are meaning that the room is very dark. That's the difference between a compound word and a noun phrase. Okay?
Yes.
She's a grandmother. That means the mother is very grand. But if you are saying that this is my grandmother, there you are stressing only the first part, the first syllable, because it's a compound word. Is the idea clear? So stress helps you to distinguish between a compound word and a noun phrase.
That means in compound word, we stress on the first syllable.
Which part is more important? Carry the stress. Often the first part.
Okay.
But in the case of a noun phrase, you have to stress both the words.
Yes, yes.
Then certain rules are given here. Rules for placement of stress. First of all, we should understand that stress is free. Because in the case of English, stress cannot be predicted. So if you have only, if you have a monosyllabic word, it is easy. Otherwise, it becomes a bit difficult. Okay. For example, there are certain words which take S as a suffix. That means it's an inflectional suffix. Inflectional suffix means suffix related to grammar. So in order to make a noun into a plural form, into its plural form, you add S or ES. In that case, stress doesn't change. Cat, cats, dog, dogs, all those are inflectional suffixes. Earlier, we saw that Democrat, the word Democrat, the stress on the word Democrat keeps on changing when you add suffixes. Democratic, democratic. When you keep on adding certain things, the democracy, so the stress also changes. But in case of inflectional suffix, even when you add an inflectional suffix to a word, the stress doesn't change. Did you understand what is an inflectional suffix?
Inflectional suffix only, that is S and ED.
No, just S or ED. The S, ES, then D, ED. All these are all the words related to grammar. So in order to take, in order to convert a word into past tense, in order to show the verb form S, again, in order to show plural form of noun, we use inflectional suffix. That means a grammatical suffix. So all those, whenever you add a grammatical suffix to a word, inflectional suffix to a word, the stress doesn't change. The inflectional suffix do not influence stress. Inflectional suffixes do not influence stress. Some derivational suffixes also do not affect stress. For example, age. Age is a suffix. It's a derivational suffix. Even though it's a derivational suffix, it doesn't influence, it doesn't affect the stress. For example, post, breakage. Similarly, hood, childhood, manhood, womanhood. Even when you add hood to a word, doesn't change. The stress doesn't change. Okay. Clear?
Okay.
See, the certain suffixes are given there. A list of suffixes are given there. So when you add these suffixes to words, the stress doesn't change. Ish, child, childish, fool, foolish. The stress always remain on the first syllable, child, childish. Stress remains on child, the first syllable, ch. Even when you add ish to the word. Okay, clear?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay, next rule. But some derivational suffixes influence stress or they affect stress. Either it takes the stress or it affects the stress. For example, employee. Okay, employee. So when you convert the word into employee, it's not another noun. It takes the noun. It takes the stress. That suffix takes the stress. See, the stress falls on the last syllable. That is the suffix itself. Employee. He was the suffix. The stress falls on the suffix itself. Employee. Similarly, address. Addressee. When you add, when you convert the word address into another noun, addressee, again the stress moves to the suffix. Addressee. Clear?
Yes, yes.
Is it clear? Again, government. Governmental. Again, you added AL. It's a suffix. Governmental. Adjectival suffix. So, when you add that adjectival suffix to government, it's a noun. The stress also changes. See, in the first word, government, the stress was on the first syllable. Look at the word government. The stress went to the third syllable. Okay?
If you consider management, manage.
Menace what?
Menace and management.
Both the same. Menace. M-E-N-A-C-E. Is that what you meant?
That means M-E-N-T, the suffix. That means what are the for the syllables where you can stress on? Menace. Management.
His word is management.
Management.
No, actually. Management. Management.
Management.
M-A-N-A-G-E, manage.
M-A-N-A-G-E, manage. Management.
Manage, yes.
M-E-N-T takes the stress.
Okay,
sorry,
okay.
Even when you manage and management, the stress remain on the same syllable, manage. Manage, management. It doesn't change. M-E-N-T is a suffix which doesn't change the stress. But if you are making it into managemental, the stress changes to mental.
Okay, ma'am.
If you are converting manage into management, it doesn't change. But if you are adding TAL to that word, it changes the stress. Because TAL is a suffix which changes the stress, which influences, which affects the stress. Clear?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, I'm saying here govern, government, like that manage, management. So whether the stress is changed or
no.
There in the management.
There the stress doesn't change. But in the case of managemental, the stress changes.
Okay.
Clear? Management.
You say managemental.
Managemental. See, if you are using the word management, the stress falls on the first syllable. If it is manage, it's a verb, the stress falls on the second syllable. But when you are adding managemental, the stress moves to the mental, the third syllable.
Okay.
Because manage is a verb. Usually verb takes second syllable. Even in the case of govern, if you're taking government, the stress falls on the first syllable. If you're taking govern, the stress is on the second syllable.
Okay, yes, ma'am.
Is it what you asked?
Yes, ma'am.
So for the verb
okay,
manage, the word manage is a verb. Usually for all the verbs, most of the verb, the stress falls on the second syllable, manage.
Yes,
I can't manage it. So the stress falls on the second syllable. But if it is management, the stress falls on the first syllable. But if it is managemental issue, the stress moves to mental, that third syllable.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Is that clear? Okay. Similarly,
yes,
offers is noun. The stress comes in the first syllable. See, that's a noun, office. But if you are converting it into an adjective, official, the stress moves to the second syllable, official. Okay, so some derivational suffixes either receive or affect stress. That means it can influence stress. I think it's time. Shall we discuss the rest of the block in the next class? Some examples are given here. I think you can go for the examples. Stress and rhythm, I'll take in the next class.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
It's going to be a big, big topic, so I don't think I'll be able to finish all these things within 10 or 15 minutes. It'll take down some other 20 minutes. Don't worry, we'll discuss it in next class. That is on Tuesday.
Okay, okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, if you could share the PPT.